expressing data as linear combinations of both inliers and outliers. And we demonstrated that if a point is an inlier, it has a sparse representation with respect to the rest of the data. If a point is an outlier, then it doesn't have a sparse representation in general. Therefore, by just looking at how sparse the representation is, we can detect inliers versus outliers. In practice, because we cannot solve a sparse representation problem exactly, we do L1 minimization. And once we do that, we need to eventually threshold the L1 norm of the coefficients that we get. And I argued that instead of having sparsity, what was the expected level of sparsity? The expected level of sparsity was the dimension of the subspace. In reality, once we apply with L1 minimization, we're not going to get that exactly. And a priori, we actually don't know the dimensions. So the method was based on having a threshold on the L1 norm of the coefficients, with the expectation that that L1 norm is large for outliers and that L1 norm is small for inliers. And I have promised to discuss a little bit more in depth where the threshold is from, but I didn't have time to go through all of the technical details yet, so I'll try to do it on Friday. So what I'll do today is move on with the next topic that I promised, which was that everything we've discussed insofar has been convex optimization methods for dealing with outliers. In reality, the big disadvantage of those convex methods is that for big data, if the dimension is big, if the number of training examples is big, we face the problem of very large-scale convex optimization problems. So what I promised to do today was working in the factorized space the same way we did originally for PCA, which is that we decompose the data into a basis and the coefficients, and try to see how we can exploit those techniques to be able to deal with the big data domain and avoid having to compute the SVD or gigantic matrix. So I'll begin with how we could do outlier detection. So I'll begin by recalling what we did for PCA. And so in PCA, what we did was to minimize the sum of the squared errors. So each data point, xj, was approximately equal to a mean minus the basis times the low dimensional representation. And we minimized this with respect to mu, u, and y. So that's how we did classical PCA. And so the key reason why this method is not robust to outliers is because effectively for each data point it computes what is the distance from that data point to the point in the subspace. And the point in the subspace is mu plus mu times yj. And so if we have data points that are sort of here, that's fine. But as soon as I have a point that is very far from the subspace, what I will have is the distance from that to this subspace, and that distance is going to be very large. And the algorithm would like to minimize that distance. So the subspace is going to be moved so that the error with respect to the outliers is smaller. And because we're using the square norm, then effectively all of the errors are penalized equally. So in the alternating minimization approach, which in fact comes from the literature in robust statistics, so the idea behind these methods based on robust statistics is sort of the following. If I had a way of knowing which points are inliers versus which ones are outliers, I could assign a certain weight to those data points. So in particular, suppose that I define wj for each data point, I'm going to have a weight. And that weight is going to be a number, say between 0 and 1, with the following ideal property. I'd like wj to be, if I could do this, right? If this is 1 when j is an inliner, and 0 when j is an outlier. Okay, what would happen? So in a sense, it's almost like if you gave me the separation of which point is an inlier and outlier, what would you do?
Well, if I've got a weight, what I can do is the following. I can go ahead and minimize the sum. And what I'm going to do is just put a weighted error here. So I'm going to use that weight, wj, xj minus u minus u times 1j. J plus 1. So what happens if I use this weighting scale? What's going to happen is that every point that is an outlier will get a zero weight. And every point that is an inlier will get a weight that is equal to 1. So instead of being the sum of the square of the errors from every data point to the subspace, is going all of the terms that correspond to the outliers will have zero weight, so they don't matter anymore. So effectively, this objective is the sum of the squares or the distances from the inliers to the subspace. Okay? And therefore, if I knew what those weights are, I could get the same estimate that I wanted, which is just fit the subspace to the inlier. And this is simply just a mathematical way to write it. Okay? And so, again, we optimize here over mu, over u, and over y. Okay. The reality is, however, that I don't know what weights to give to begin with. Okay? So as a consequence, I also need to optimize with respect to the w. Or I need to have a way of defining those weights. Okay. So here's the basic principle behind many of the methods in robust statistics, or the so-called M estimate. The basic idea is the following. One, set the WJs to be 1. So at the beginning, you don't know which points are inliers and which points are outliers. Two, find subspace, or find S, okay? Set of X's that are equal to mu plus u1. In other words, it's just find u and find mu, find the subspace, given those weights. So just apply the CA to the entire data set. Now, the idea is, given S, compute W. And this last step is sort of the critical thing, because the idea is the following. If I go ahead and I have some guess now of what the subspace is, how would you define those weights? Right? And so what would your natural intuition tell you? If, once you have an estimate of what that subspace is, a point is very close to that subspace, your intuition will tell you that that point should be an inlier. If that point is very far from the subspace, your intuition will tell you that that is an outlier. So the idea is to come up with a weighting scheme that assigns a weight that is maybe not identically equal to 1, but high, for points that are close to the estimated subspace, and a weight that is small for points that are far from the subspace. So, of course, there are lots of ways by which I can do that. So I could say, for example, that wj is 1 if the distance between xj and s is less than some threshold. Right? And I could decide that w is 0 if the distance is real. Then you say less than real. So that would be one way. Key question is that I now have to pick this threshold, and that depends on the typical distribution of distances from points to the estimated subspace. That could be highly variable. So that's one potential way to do it. The second potential way to do it is maybe I'll simply say that wj could be
E to the minus the distance between xj and the subspace squared over maybe 2 sigma squared. That automatically means that if the distance is small, e to the minus nearly 0 is almost 1. And if the distance is very large, then w is going to be nearly 0. But now you get a continuous weight as opposed to a discrete weight. Okay? So those are sort of intuitive ways by which I could define those distances. But more broadly, what could I do? And so here's the way in which this is typically done. So the idea really is that the L2 norm square is the problem. And maybe if I come up with a different way of penalizing the errors, I could get a more robust estimate. And so the key idea behind the robust estimators is to effectively do the following. We're going to compute some error, which could just be exactly the any norm of the distances, really. So in this particular case, I'm just going to pick the distance. But maybe what I'm going to do is to minimize the sum from j equals 1 to capital N of some function rho of these errors, okay? Where rho is what is typically known as the robust function. Okay? And what is the idea behind a robust function? The idea is sort of the following. If in the classical scenario, that robust function is just the square, so this is rho of e is equal to e squared. And that has the problem, as I've just discussed, that large errors are highly penalized because you get a quadratic. Okay? And because large errors are highly penalized, these very large errors will influence the optimal solution that you obtain very heavily. So the goal of this robust function is to have a different way to penalize that hopefully large errors don't influence the solution as much. So people have proposed a wide variety of possible solutions. Evidently, using the L1 is one of them. So that possibility is just rho v is that the value of v. Okay, so that's another option. Then there is something called the Huber laws. And what is the Huber laws? The Huber laws is sort of a mixture of the two. The idea is that near the origin, a quadratic is generally very good. It would facilitate the optimization, typically when you have a least squares problem. Having these quadratic objectives make your life easier. And the issue with L1 typically is that you have this non-differentiability. But past some threshold, you don't want to go quadratic, and then you go linear. So the idea of the Huber laws is that you have something like a quadratic here, but then from some point on, you just have a line. Okay. So let me actually define it more formally, but it's exactly what I've said. You first have a quadratic, and then you have a line. Where is it? So the Huber laws, rho of e is equal to e squared if e is less than epsilon 0, and is 2 times epsilon 0 e minus epsilon 0 squared alpha. Okay? So it's a combination of L2 squared and L1. Okay? And this was proposed in 1981. Okay, this is called the one loss. So there are two more that people usually use. One is the so-called Cauchy loss. That would be rho of E is equal to epsilon squared logarithm. So this one is a little bit more like this. It's like the logarithm. So, okay. So of course it's always increasing, so maybe I didn't do the drawing properly. But what's the idea behind this loss? The idea is that both, I mean in the L2 squared, you really penalize the large errors a lot. In the L1, you penalize them less, but still linearly. In this Cauchy loss, what you do is that it starts to saturate. I mean, it still grows to infinity, right? The logarithm is not bounded, but you've got a concave function. And then there is the last one that is the given. And that one really saturates, and that is rho of E is equal to E squared divided by E squared plus epsilon squared. And that is more like this. So near zero, you really get almost a quadratic, because near zero, this term goes away, so you really get E squared. But when E is large, this goes away. Okay, so you get a little bit of a quadratic effect here, but then it does end up. Okay. So those are the several different losses that people have proposed. Okay? And so, the way in which the minimization is now done is as follows. You, as I said, we want to minimize the sum j equals 1 to n now of rho of E sub I. And what we do is effectively the following. We write it as rho of E sub I divided by EI squared. And now we pretend that this guy is the weight. Okay. And so effectively, this trick, what it does is, you know, I haven't done anything, it's really just moving variables around. But effectively what this does is the following. I start with a minimization problem that I change the rho arbitrarily, and I gave you several examples of what the rho would look like. And by the way, many of these examples, the functions are all non-convex. Some of them are non-differentiable. So optimization-wise, is a priori a very nasty problem, what I'm defining here. But via this simple trick, what you do is that now you put a weight, but you somewhat convert it into a quadratic problem with weights. Now, I'm really sweeping something under the rug here, and what I'm sweeping under the rug is that effectively this weight is a function of the error. In fact, it's just the value of the robust error divided by E squared. Okay, so it's really, I'm not doing anything. But what people do, and the trick is sort of the following. Now you've converted it to something that looks like a quadratic problem as before. So although this guy is a function of the errors, you can sort of do this in an iterative way and pretend for a moment that it's not, which is sort of the following. Fix the current values of the weights. Now you get a quadratic problem that I haven't told you how to solve yet, but it really looks like your quadratic, like the BCA problem we had before. So hopefully it's doable. Hopefully we can do a weighted version of BCA that will not be too more complicated. Okay, so let's assume for the time being that I know how to do weighted BCA. Once I know how to do weighted BCA, given E, I can go ahead and recompute the weights. How? It's a closed form formula because it's whatever robust function that I chose divided by E squared, and that's going to give me the new set of weights. Okay. So here's going to be the strategy. Given W, solve W equal to 1. So I should probably give it a name. This is the problem I have here. Or maybe let me see the stars, since I've got so many other letters. So given W, solve the problem star. And now, number two is given the EJs now, we compute WJ as rho of EJ divided by EJ squared. Okay. So that's going to be the strategy. And for the sake of simplicity, let me take the very last loss as an example. That last loss already had the E squared in the numerator. Okay, so the weights are immediately defined. So let me give that as an example. So if rho of E is E squared divided by E squared plus epsilon 0 squared, then the weight associated with error E is just going to be 1 over E squared plus E0 squared. Okay, that's the weight that I'm going to give to a sample point. And how does this weight behave? If you go ahead and plot it, right, when the error is 0, is 1 over epsilon 0 squared. And when E goes to infinity, it goes to 0. Okay, so the weighting scheme in this particular case does exactly what we wanted, which is that for points that are close to the subspace, we give them a high value, and for points that are far from the subspace, we give them zero, not zero, but a small weight. Okay. So that's exactly what happened. So what are the two questions that I need to answer in order to implement an algorithm of this form? Question number one is, how do you solve the weighted BCA problem? Okay? So this is the first question. The second question is, okay, the second step is probably trivial. Right, it's just evaluate the new weight and just repeat. So it's like a, this is actually well known, it's an algorithm that is known as reweighted, this is, it's really a variant of reweighted least squares. The next question is, however, well, why does this algorithm make sense? In a sense, my goal is to minimize the sum of robust errors. Will this iterative scheme converge to the minimizer of that sum of robust errors? So for some problems, the answer is that yes, people have studied the question of convergence of iterative reweighted least squares. If the objective, if the errors as a function of the parameters where linear or convex, people can have come up with proofs for some particular types of row functions. But for the problem we have in mind, that's very, very difficult to do because the error is to begin with a non-convex function of u and y. Okay.
So what I'm effectively telling you is that this is a very nice formulation, a very intuitive formulation. It's going to lead to a solution that is efficiently computable. But the theoretical justification for it isn't as strong as for those non-convex problems, as for those convex problems that we discussed before. Okay. All right, so let me address the first question, which is how do we solve the weighted PCA problem? So if you had to guess, what would the solution be, right? So we did PCA already, and what was the solution? The solution to classical PCA was mu, the mu parameter. What was the mu parameter?
The mean
of the data. Okay. Then, how did I compute the u, the basis for the subspace?
From the sample covariance matrix.
The sample covariance matrix. So I compute the sample covariance matrix, and then I get the eigenvectors. Or I do the singular vectors of the data. Those were the two possibilities, right? Okay. So, if you had to guess now, what would modification need to be done to consider the weights that we checked?
Weighted mean, weighted sample covariance.
Weighted mean, weighted sample covariance. So, for step one, what you would think is that the mu is going to be the weighted mean, okay? So usually it should have been the sum of the xj's divided by n. That would have been the regular mean, right? But now I'm going to do a weighted mean. So each point is going to be weighted by wj, okay? But if I do that, because the weights are any numbers between 0 and 1, I don't have any in the denominator. What should I put in the denominator?
Sums of the W's.
Sums of the W's. Okay. So that's how I expect I would be able to compute mu. And that might be my estimate of mu. And my estimate of sigma, how do I compute the weighted covariance matrix? Well, presumably I'll do maybe the same, right? So usually I have xj minus mu hat and xj minus mu hat transpose. That's what we have usually. And usually this quantity is also divided by n in the denominator, right? That's sort of the typical covariance calculation. So hopefully I can do this with putting wj in there and putting that in J. Okay, so I compute a weighted mean, I compute a weighted covariance, and then I'm going to do the U in the eigenvectors of sigma. Okay? Now, I don't want to do the proofs of everything again because I've done this over and over multiple times, so let me just do one piece that is easy enough to convince you that this is what happens. So what we can just do is minimize sum wj xj minus mu minus mu times yj 2 squared. By the way, I forgot to write all of the constraints in there, right? But we want u transpose u to be the identity. We want the average of the yj's to be zero. And what else do we want? So those were the two major constraints that we have. Okay. But in particular, let's just take the derivative with respect to mu and set it to zero, which would be the way to compute the optimal mu. So we get a sum wj, so the derivative of the square is going to be 2 times what's inside. Okay, so that's what the derivative of the square is, 2 times. And then times the derivative of what's inside with respect to mu, and there is just a minus sign there. So it's minus that. And that is equal to 0.
here I get that the sum of wj xj is equal to mu times the sum of the wj's plus mu times the sum of the yj's, right? All I did now is everything with a negative sign, so these two guys, I'm going to move them to the right, okay? So I get the sum of this part is equal to the sum of these two. So that's mu times the sum plus u, and now I get the sum of the yj's. But because the AI is supposed to be, sorry, the low dimensional representation is supposed to be centered, then this part is zero. And that's how I get that mu is equal to the sum of wj, xj divided by the sum of wj's. Okay? But like that, you can just reconstruct all of the derivations that I did at the beginning of the class now for the weighted case, and you will convince yourself that this is exactly what you're supposed to do. Okay? So, bottom line, let me write it down now in a form of algorithm that is implementable. So this is just for you to know exactly, I'm just writing down algorithm 3.9 from the book. So how do you do robust ECA? So first, you initialize. And as I said, where was that? Okay, really what I'm trying to redo is what I said there at the beginning. Set all the weights to be 1 and find the subspace with all of the weights being equal to 1. So this is now summarized on, you initialize mu, u, and y. Effectively, by applying PCA to the data x. That's exactly what steps 1 and 2 are. Set all the weights to 1 and find the subspace. What's that? Just do PCA to the data as is, with every data point weighted as being equal to 1. So that's the initialization. So then we're going to repeat the following process. We compute the error. And the error, I had already defined it. Where was my error? I defined it here. That's what my error is. Okay. So I'm just putting that in the algorithm right now. So the error is xj minus mu minus u times yj. So I gotta go ahead and compute the error. Then I also compute the weights. There is lots of choice of how I might compute the weights, but I'm going to choose maybe this one because it leads to weights that are easily computable. So that's what I have over there, right? Where did I draw it here at the top? So I'm going to find my weight. In fact, so that the weights are, you know, the weights are exactly what I did over there, but maybe the only annoying thing is that instead of the maximum weight being equal to 1, is 1 over epsilon 0 squared. Okay, because epsilon 0 is a constant that I get to choose, I'm just going to scale the objective and scale all of the weights by the same constant, and obviously that doesn't change anything. So what I'm going to do is really to define the ways to have the epsilon 0 squared in the numerator so that this number is equal to 1, and so that the weights are between 0 and 1. So that's exactly what I'm going to do here. So the weights are going to be epsilon 0 squared divided by ej squared plus epsilon 0 squared. Okay. So the same weighting scheme that I had said before, but I'm just scaling it by epsilon 0. Then I compute mu as the weighted average. Then I compute sigma as the weighted covariance. Okay. And then u, the top D eigenvectors. that we know from PCA. If I knew the basis, if I knew everything else, how do I compute the low-dimensional representation? I take the data, I subtract the mean, and project onto the subset. Just remember that the geometric picture is always, you take the data, subtract the mean, and project. And so I take the data, I subtract the mean, and then I project. And there we are. Right. So that's going to be the algorithm. And I repeat this until convergence. And there are lots of ways of defining convergence. You could say that the mean, all of the parameters should not change from iteration to iteration. That's sort of the typical thing. And so the delta mu, the delta sigma, the delta u should be small.
Does each iteration cause the error, the objective function to decrease, guaranteed?
The answer is yes, but it's not immediately evident. The typical way by which you prove that this is so is that you actually have an objective function that in this particular case would be a function of both the weights that you're computing as well as the parameters of the PCA problem. And therefore, given the PCA parameters, you compute the weights, and given the weights, you compute PCA. For that to happen, I would need, right, if you look at the way the objective has been written, the step of giving the weight solved for the parameters, that's fairly clear. That has to reduce the objective, right? Because that's the way I compute it. Given W's, I solve for the optimal PCA parameter. But the part that is not so evident that will reduce the error is the fact that given the parameters, which effectively says given the E sub I's, I recompute the weights. The optimal solution to that without any constraint on the weight, what would that be? If the W's, if all the constraints you've got on the W's is that they have to be between 0 and 1, right? And the E sub I's are now fixed, right? And you say, compute the WJ's for me. The optimal solution is going to be that you're going to set WJ to be 1 for the smallest EJ and 0 for all the others, under the assumption that you constrain also the weights to add up to 1. Okay? So this way of computing the weights according to the formula given by the robust error is not an alternating minimization procedure, that therefore I can guarantee that it's decreasing the objective based on the typical argument that when you do alternative minimization, you go down. So the argument is a little bit more involved, and it has to do with what in optimization is called a majorization minimization approach, where you effectively replace your objective by majorization means that you do an upper bound, and then you minimize that upper bound. And so that's what I mean that the proof and the analysis of convergence is a little bit more subtle. But based on those techniques, you can demonstrate that you are going down with both steps. Okay. All right. Now, computationally, did I do anything better than what I had before, or is it sort of the same? So the good news is that effectively what this does is that it reduces the problem to classical PCA, and all I need to do is repeat classical PCA multiple times, and each time with a different set of weights. So what is the computational complexity? It's going to be as complex as solving one PCA problem multiple times, and so the number of iterations times the complexity of PCA is the complexity of this algorithm. The way in which I've written this, it's not quite targeted to high-dimensional data. Computational domain is essentially trivial, but the major bottleneck and the major issue will be the calculation of the covariance matrix. So the covariance matrix would be D by D, where D is the dimension of the data. And so this can be a very large matrix to compute, okay? And then, on top of that, I need to do the SVD of that covariance. No, this is not the SVD, this is the eigenvalue decomposition, okay? So the fundamental problem is that I've got this very large matrix. So the beauty of it is, however, that now you can replace the step of calculation of the covariance or the step of the calculation of the eigenvectors of a matrix by faster algorithms. And the overall algorithm is the same, because all what you need at the end of the day is solve weighted PCA at every iteration. The way I've written it is not particularly efficient. And in fact, if you compare it to the convex methods, like the singular value thresholding algorithm for doing robust PCA, what was the computational cost of that? That was an alternation between doing the SVD and shrinking the singular values, and then thresholding, right? That was the alternation. So over there, the thresholding was also trivial. The core of the calculation was do the SVD of the entire data set. So this method has the same problem. It's an iterative procedure, and at each iteration, I need to do the eigenvalue decomposition. Alternatively, it could also be done using the SVD, because you immediately are going to guess, right? What is the alternative of doing this with the SVD? Well, instead of computing the covariance and then getting the top eigenvector, what can you do? Just take the data, weight it by the weights, and then do the SVD. Okay? So I haven't gained much by proceeding this way. So if computation was the criteria, the key question would be which algorithm converges faster, right? Because at the end of the day, it's the number of iterations. The key thing, however, is that there are ways of computing these eigenvectors very fast. Okay, so that's one way that one can gain. But that's also applicable to the other. All of the problems with the same philosophy, and that's what I want to finish today, is tell you that in fact we can also do matrix completion, and we can also do robustness with respect to outliers using the same philosophy. And so in the next lecture on Friday, I'll tell you how we do this very fast. Okay, so let me move now to the next problem, which is, what if I had outliers? Outlying entries. What if I had missing entries? How would I apply the same philosophy to the problem? So, in the classical PCA, this was the objective. Let me expand that out. This was the sum of j. I can expand this out. Now I'm going to say this is the sum over I and j. And I'm going to do it entry by entry now. So this is xij minus mu I minus u I transpose y j squared. That's actually the objective, where I've written it down now, entry by entry of the entire matrix. So when I go to the situation where this is x, and I tell you now that some fraction of the entries is being corrupted, right? Now I need to do something a little bit different. In the case of outliers, an entire column is corrupted. And in fact, we define this weight Wj that I talked about, which was one weight per column, that tells me, is that column an outlier, yes or no? And that was the weight being one or zero accordingly. Now, the corruptions or the missing entries are going to be entries. And so the key modification and the insight I hope to convince you is that all we need to do is to put a weight that is Wij in front. So we have one weight entry by entry. And now we minimize that. Now, in the PCA with missing entries, what happens? In the PCA with missing entries, I actually know which entries are missing and which entries are not. So all what I'm going to do really is I'll have Wij is equal to 1 if ij is observed and 0 otherwise. So in fact, supposedly this is a slightly simpler problem than the one we just discussed, because I know which entries are missing. Now, in the second case, which is PCA with robustness to outliers, robustness to corrupted entries, in this case, I don't know the Wij's. So what I'm going to do is exactly what I just talked about, which is that I'm going to define the Wij's to be equal to, what did I do? I did epsilon 0 squared divided by Eij squared plus epsilon 0 squared, where now Eij is equal to exactly what I have there, absolute value of Xij minus mu I minus ui transpose yj. Okay? And the beauty and the interesting thing is that actually it's essentially almost the same optimization problem for both the case of missing entries as well as the case of corrupted entries, with the only difference being that in the case of missing entries, the Wij's are either 0 or 1, depending on which entries are missing. And therefore, I will need to solve the optimization problem only once. Okay? I don't need to do this alternation between given the weight, do weight in PCA, and given PCA, recompute the weights, as we just did. I just need to do that once. In the second case, however, I will need to do the alternation, because given the weights, and evidently we're going to start in the same way as before, all of the weights are equal to 1, so the first step is going to be do PCA. Right? Given the weights, I will be able to do, hopefully, a version of this weighted PCA. Of course, it needs to be different, and we need to discuss how we're going to do it. But hopefully, you can be convinced that there is a way of solving this problem when the Wij's are fixed. And then, given u, y, and mu, I can very easily compute the errors. And given the errors, I can recompute the weights. And then I'll iterate. And so at a high level, the procedure will be in the same spirit. And the key difference is only that the one I just discussed has weights that are column by column, while this one has weights that are entry by entry. And then between this and this, this will require iterations. This one needs to be done only once. You have a question?
Yeah, I just, is there a reason it's absolute value there and not squared?
I don't think it ever was squared, and that's actually a type.
because maybe I erased it, or maybe it's still under here. Here's the thing. See? This is the definition of E is everything before I take the square. So that for the L2 square norm, I get back the classical PCA. Right? So this is the L2 square. So that's why when I define E, I should not take the square. Okay? And that's why in this particular case, the absolute value. So everything is just based distance to the subspace. Or now that we're doing it entry by entry, is effectively what this really is distance from the data to the model. Absolute value. Okay. Any other question? All right, so I hope to have convinced you that at the end of the day, the key question is how do I solve this problem when W is fixed? Okay. And here is the unfortunate situation. When the weights are equal to 1, then it's classical PCA. I just do the SVD or the mean centering and all of that, and I'm done. When I have a scheme like the one that I just described here, where every column of every data point is weighted, or every column effectively is weighted by a single weight, what was the solution? The solution is really PCA. It's just that it's applied to the data being weighted before you get started. Right? But still, it can be done in a single short way. It's like, this is the problem, just compute the covariance, do the SVD, I have the solution. The issue is that it is no longer the case when I have weights that are in an entry by entry way. And intuitively, the reason is that that case was easier because in the extreme case, if you're just weighting the columns, and some of them are weighted by 1 and some of them are weighted by 0, the ones that are weighted, it's really like solving a reduced PCA problem where you just eliminate some of the data points. Now it's really entry by entry, and so it's much more intricate. But still, what you can do effectively, and that's what we're going to do, is an alternating procedure now, where there is no way. I cannot just do this based on matrix factorization. What I'll have to do effectively is, given U, solve for Y, given Y, solve for U, and so on. So forth. Okay. So let me write that down and have it. Okay, so for example, let me compute, as I just did before, what is the derivative of the objective function now just with respect to the ith entry of the mean vector. So, in this particular case, it's going to be sum. Okay, look at it. This is a sum over j and a sum over I. That's what the objective is. But the sum over I, it will disappear because I'm taking the derivative just with respect to the ith entry. Okay? So, effectively, you can always say, and maybe I should spell it out. Here, I have a sum from I of 1 to 0, and I have a sum from j of 1 to n, right? So if I look at the outer sum, and I need to compute the derivative of this with respect to mu I, the first term depends only on mu 1, the second one only on mu 2, and so on and so forth. So out of the capital D terms, there is just one of them that depends on mu I, and that is the ith term. So the sum over I will disappear, and I only get the sum over j. And the sum will be the same as before. So I get the 2 times xij minus mu I minus mu I transpose of ij. And then I've got the minus 1, and equal to 0. And so from here, I forgot the weights, right? I've got WIJ. So from here, I'm going to get that the sum of WIJ with respect to J times mu sub I is equal to the sum J plus 1 of Xij minus Ui transpose Yj, and all of that weighted by Wij. And so here is the part that is that destroys a few things, right? In what I did here, and I hope you appreciate that here, that became zero, right? That became zero. Actually, I almost lied to you and you didn't correct me. So now that I'm going back through it, I realize the typo. Right. What's the typo? There's a typo. Anyone can discover it. Huh? Wj is missing, right? Here I'm supposed to have a Wj. Right? And now you're going to say, oh, everything I said was wrong because I said that that thing is zero. Okay? But, think about it. In the case without outliers, we want the representation to be centered, so we want the average of the WJs to be zero. If someone, an oracle, told you these are inliers and these are outliers, do you want the representation of everything to be centered? Or do you think you just want the representation of the inliers to be centered? And you don't, I mean, the outliers, you don't care. What do you think is more reasonable? Just the inliers, right? So if the weights are exactly zeros and ones, what you want is not the sum of all the representations to be zero, but weighted by the WJs, right? Correct? So that's why everything was correct, but there was a typo there that I'm now fixing. So by analogy, right, I could go here and I could simplify matters. And how would I simplify matters? What I would need a constraint that the sum of the Wij's, Yj's are zero. That's what I would need. Okay? If that was the case, if I could impose that constraint, then I would be in business. But it's not as trivial anymore why this constraint makes sense. I think in this example, it's very clear because I'm saying the low dimensional representation of the inliers must be centered. Here, what does this mean? Right? In fact, it's like multiple centerings because I've got this, this is some with respect to J, but. Right, but there is an I over there. So it's like different weighting scheme depending on the missing pattern entries. So enforcing that this is zero doesn't make much sense because I would be enforcing it multiple times with different weighting schemes. So it's weird. So that's why we keep it there. Okay. But if I could disregard, okay, if I could disregard the second term, I would like to provide an immediate interpretation as to what that iteration of the algorithm is actually doing, at least in the matrix completion case. So if I could enforce that the sum of the Wij, Yj's was equal to zero, then look at what I would get. I would get that the ith entry of mu is simply sum of Wij
xj divided by the sum of the y, right? That would be the solution. And this is sum of j equals 1 to n, sum of j equals 1 to n. Okay? So this is almost like doing, and I would like to do this picture, right? I've got my matrix. There are a bunch of missing entries all over. And supposedly, if the matrix was complete, I'm supposed to compute the average of that matrix, right? What is this thing doing? What is the average, right? You take, if I do it entry by entry, I would be taking one row and computing the average of that row, correct? But what's going to happen now, if for example, if I go to this row, if I try to do it for this row, there is a missing entry there. Maybe there is a missing entry there. So I can't compute the average because there are some entries that are missing. So what do I do in this case? It's like, well, just don't sum the parts that are missing and just divide by the number of observed entries in that row. That's exactly what this calculation is saying. It's compute the weighted average. In fact, if these wij's are 0 or 1, depending on whether that entry is missing or not, what this says is, row by row, compute the average, or compute the sum of the observed entries only, and divide every row by the number of observed entries for that row. That is what this calculation is. Okay? So it's a way of computing the mean for incomplete data. By analogy, you would say, well, if we just do that, then we would be in business, right? Why don't I do the same thing for the covariance? Let me do the same thing for the covariance. I'm going to compute now entry by entry the sigma ij squared, right? And I shouldn't write it like that. Maybe I should write it with the capital letters because it's really the ij entry of the sigma I. So on the far right, right, you saw what I did here. Right? And I could do it in a vector way and get a covariance vector. But if I just look at the ij entry supposedly is supposed to be xij minus mu I and probably xij minus mu j. Right? That's the way it's supposed to be, right? If I go entry by entry of what that covariance calculation is. And usually we have well, that's it. And well, it's 1 divided by n, right? Correct? So what are we going to do now? Well, we're just going to multiply by wij. Except that it's not so easy anymore. In fact, maybe I think I'm missing something. So what is it that I'm missing? Effectively, if you think about what a covariance calculation does, right, is that it takes two columns of the matrix, right? And so the ij entries, I take this column, I take that column, and I compute the outer product, right? Supposedly, I do xj minus mu. So sigma, maybe I should use the same notation as in here, sigma ik. So sigma ik would be defined as follows. No, I should do this. So I've got the metric vector, I've got the other one, I take the outer product and I sum over all the columns. So supposedly, okay, now let me get it. So supposedly, in the case of a covariance matrix, what I'm doing is xj minus mu, xj minus mu transpose, and then sum over j. That's what I do. So if I have to compute the ik entry of that matrix, I need to put x I and I over there, and now I need to put k and k over there. Okay, now I got it right. So this should be x I j minus mu I, so that's correct. And now I need to have x k j minus mu k. And now I sum, still sum over j. Okay. And I divide by n. Okay. So that is the ik entry of a full covariance matrix. Okay? So now what I'm trying to ask you is, if entries are missing, how does this get modified? Well, if the ij entry is not observed, in analogy to what we did here, we don't want that ij term to affect the calculation. So we multiply this by wij. But that there is also the kj here, so I also need to multiply by kj. Okay. And then I need to normalize now, and because not all entries are observed, I need to divide that by the sum of the observed ones, which would be sum of the wij's, wk's. So, in other words, all what I'm really doing is, can we compute the covariance matrix entry by entry in the case where some of the entries of the matrix are missing? So all I did was, how is every entry of the covariance matrix computed to begin with in the full case, and now let me eliminate the terms that are unobserved, in the same way as we do for the mean. Okay. In fact, you know what? This was one of the first methods proposed for filling in missing entries. And this was maybe in the 60s or so. If you read the first book in PCA, it contains this method as a way of handling missing entries. And all what they say is just very intuitively is, you've got to compute the mean, you've got to compute the covariance. For the mean, just compute the mean of the observed part and normalize it properly. And for the covariance, just compute the outer products, entry by entry, only considering the observed ones. Can anyone tell me what might be wrong with this procedure? What is a basic property of a covariance matrix that any covariance matrix needs to satisfy? Symmetric. Needs to be symmetric. Is the calculation I just described symmetric? So if I change I and k, is there any problem? They're changeable, right? So that's not a problem. What other property does the covariance matrix need to satisfy?
Positive
definite. Is this matrix positive definite? We don't know, really. We don't know. So a major problem with this procedure is exactly that. That is not a valid way of estimating a covariance matrix. It's very intuitive. It can handle the fact that entries are missing, but it doesn't provide a valid estimate of a covariance. Second, from a statistical perspective, means and covariances are usually estimated in a maximum likelihood sense. So we want them to be unbiased or to maximize the likelihood. These ways of defining them are purely from an optimization perspective. This first one actually was the optimum. This second one, I'm just cooking it up over there. I haven't said this calculation of the second one does not come from setting the derivatives to zero in any way, right? I just said intuitively, why don't we do the same thing?
So this is possibly the simplest way to do PCA with missing entries. And I guess you can immediately see that it can be done also with the corrupted entries by just iterating them with the computation of the weights. But it is not right, and it will not produce estimates that satisfy the basic property. The sigma will not be positive semi-definite. The estimators will not be unbiased, and so on and so forth. Okay. So this was a little bit of a parenthesis to go back to where I was coming from, which was I was trying to solve the optimization problem, and at least I wanted to make sure the optimization was right. And I ended up with, this is the way I need to solve for mu. And I said, wouldn't it be nice that that extra term disappeared? And if it does, then we end up with this simple calculation. But just to close the loop for today, I cannot disregard that extra term. So the update of the mu part of the PCA with missing entries will be just that equation that I'll have. And all what we're going to do is a form of alternating minimization, which is given mu, we can solve, in this particular case, is given u and y and w, I can solve for mu. Okay. So in the next class, I'll just finish it up on how do we solve for u and how do we solve for y. And the ultimate procedure will effectively be an alternating minimization procedure over the factors over the mean of the subspace and each one of the factors. Okay. Thank you.